ready? Hi, everyone. It is January 30th, 2017. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Sorry you're so far away. It feels like there's an ocean between us.
A chasm.
Okay. We are opening up and starting with approval of minutes of November 28th. Thank you.
Seconded.
Thank you. Any changes? All in favor?
No. Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Adjustments to the agenda.
So Mr. Yes. Neihart will be speaking to us right after the field trip presentation, and Ms. Ginsburg, right? Yes. Okay, Mr. Neihart and Ms. Ginsburg, they will be speaking to us about the gazebo pavilion at HES, and we will add two action items for cafe worker and the food services director contract, and we may be moving the budget.
Right, we may move some things around, so giving time in case Molly shows up. Okay. So we're on to the field trip. I love this part of the year.
All right, did you guys have time to look at what I sent over at all?
Yeah.
So I wanted to come in. Normally, as you may remember, we usually do a trip every 2 years. Grandma Lynch started this year, but she's a new French teacher. And she really wanted to plan a trip to France. So I kind of met with her and we talked about wanting to do that together and trying to boost enrollment again. And we did a survey of interest, saw that there's a great number of students who are interested. And so we want to do the trip next year instead of waiting 2 years. However, because we've traveled with EF a few times, my tour consultant did give us an enrollment guarantee that if we don't have 12 students enrolled, we can push the trip and their money to 2019 instead. So that is an option that we can do if we don't get enough students. So I'm here a little bit earlier than I usually am. I'd normally be here towards the end of this school year asking for 2 years, but we are hoping to be able to get approval for the trip so that we can set up a parent meeting and get students started. This one's a little bit cheaper than the last couple of trips. So hopefully that helps out with enrollment as well. Do you guys have any questions for us about the trip?
So it's next April?
April 2018.
Okay. I like that it's all contained to one country.
Yeah, I think it'll be fun.
The last one, the one my boy went on, was like amazingly great, but exhausting.
Yeah, and that's how we have the trip coming up this April. It's myself and six students, and it'll be like that, kind of moving every couple days through three countries, so we'll be a little busy.
So it's the two of you would be attending?
Yes, and then of course, we have enrollment that's higher, you know, kind of like the first couple years that I ran trips, then we would have more chaperones. So it's a chaperone for every six students. And parents are also invited as well.
So Annie, could you refresh my memory about what it means that we're endorsing, are we sponsoring? What is our responsibility here?
So this is treated just like all the other trips. The time that we had a conversation about should we endorse or not endorse was when April, you had considered a trip that would involve students from other schools or graduates.
Okay.
So in this case, the school committee always approves these trips,
right,
because they're limited to Hadley students, mm-hmm, and then we do advertise in the schools or encourage in the schools.
But we take no liability.
We take no
liability for the trip, for anything on the trip. The Massachusetts Association of School Committees has come out very strongly against doing, endorsing, and sponsoring international trips. That's my question.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well,
I think they're great. I'm just,
yeah,
you know,
so we, I think that would be a little tricky. I can certainly check with Attorney Dupre around that. Given the fact that we have school committee policy that speaks very specifically to,
mm-hmm,
field trips,
mm-hmm,
that we have an expectation that, and given the dates, some of it would probably also overlap with time that students would normally be in school, like our other,
mm-hmm,
trips have.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so given our policy language that speaks to field trips, the fact that our students would be on the field trip during,
right,
a time in which they would normally be in school, and that our staff are certainly always, I mean, their workers',
right,
compensation, they're acting as our staff.
Right.
I don't know that I think our liability, we wouldn't be free of any sort of liability. I can't see how we would be. I can certainly ask the attorney that, but just as in past trips, it's a school trip. It's no different than nature's classroom or anything else. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, but what we could do is approve the trip, ask Annie to bring our policy, existing policy, and ask the law firm to confirm that all is well. Mm-hmm. And then if we need to ask you back, we could?
Mm-hmm.
How's that sound?
Sure.
Was that, did I just hear a motion from someone?
Sure.
Okay.
I'll second the sure.
All right, so we have a motion, yes to the trip. If we need to change the policy or need to change anything after legal review, we'll let you know that we need to readdress.
Okay. Yeah, just if there are red flags.
Yep, yeah. I will absolutely.
Thank you.
All in favor of that?
Aye.
You're welcome.
Thanks.
Mr. Neihart.
And Ms. Ginsburg, I'm sorry, I didn't realize.
And Ms. Ginsburg.
Was here also.
How are you?
Good. So,
I'm Beth Ginsburg. I'm currently one of the co-presidents of the BGO. This is a project that I sort of inherited. So I think for the last maybe 8 to 10 years, there's been talk and teachers have asked for some she or a pavilion or something in the back of the elementary school, because there's really no shaded area for the kids outside on a hot day. Or if the teachers want to go outside and do a lesson outside, there's not really a spot. So 2014-15, the Subaru program, he gave a big donation to the PTO, and we had a say what the money was going to go to. So we had selected to do a pavilion and also the rock wall, which the rock wall is now complete. And people have been asking, so I'm like out of breath. people have been asking when is this gonna happen. So I met with Tim earlier this year, and he has agreed to help lead this project.
Yeah, so Beth first approached me and said, what do we need for permits? And she told me what it is about. So we've done a number of these in the past. My wife and I have taken on the large playground at the elementary school. Mm-hmm. We helped with that. We helped coordinate the bell and a few others. So I said, let's do some volunteers. I know some guys that would be more than willing to help. I went and approached Tom Harris at Architectural Timber and Millwork up on Mount Warner. He has over the years said, you know, the town's really helped me out. If there's anything that kind of fits with what we do up there, I would love to help out the town. I thought this would be a great fit for him because he does some incredible type of enormous structures. So I went out and talked to him and said, hey, this is something that we're looking at. Would you be willing to help? And he jumped right on it. So we've had a couple meetings, and I did meet with Jeff Mish to try to figure out precisely where it could go. There was some issues with possibly a fence that might have to go around the smaller playground. So we figured out about where it can go, kind of gave an idea of what the size could be. But I'm working with Tom Harris, and we're thinking something large, like 24, 26 feet wide, by up to 48 feet long. And we don't want to do the typical pavilion with the typical type of roof trusses that you see. What he'd like to do was some nice, big, heavy timber king trusses, something that looks really architecturally pleasing. And so I started talking to some of the contractors around here, and of course everybody's jumping on the bandwagon, said they would really like to help out. So I think we have enough volunteers. I have enough volunteers for, especially with Tom, to manufacture the thing, because it will be manufactured up at his plant up on Mount Warner and will be then assembled down here. So we're back and forth on a few items and how the design's going to be, and that will also determine what we're going to do to the roof. I'd like to see a metal roof on there, since we're doing metal roofs on all the other buildings. Try to pull that in with all the other buildings. So, we still have quite a bit of work, but we just wanted to tell you where we are and hopefully get your blessing if this is something that you guys want to do.
So where's the site?
The site is in back of the elementary school, like where the L is towards the small playground. And there's a memorial tree there, but it would fit right in that area.
Mm-hmm. And it's going to be low maintenance. I'm sure you've gone all over this with
you. Yes, that's one of the things that we talked about our last meeting. Mm-hmm. We want it so you guys don't have to do a lot of maintenance on the thing at all. And one of the other reasons why we hopefully that if everything works out, that we can do a metal roof on it. So, like some of the other things that we've done in the past, we'll have a basic idea, but we'll also say, well, if the money's there, we'll do this, this, and this. So there's been a lot of thought process on this. You know, we're certainly going to put some storage out there. We're going to bring electric out there. But, you know, I want to be able to have picnic tables, have that part of this project. And I think that we can get those at a very reduced price by some of the big boxes and a couple other things. You know, I talked to Jeff Mish, and that's something you guys want to talk about. If we want classrooms, these days, you know, it's not the old chalkboard that we're used to, so, you know, maybe we can bring I don't know what they call them now, smart boards or whatever. You know, whatever you guys want, you tell us what you like, and we'll see what we can do for you.
Sounds good. Well, Tim, I just have to say this is incredible. I think outdoor learning spaces are so valuable and up and coming. People are realizing students need to be stimulated by the outdoors and they can learn from the outdoor environment as much as they can from the indoor environment. So I have to say that I didn't really fully understand what this project was, but I'm really excited to hear that it's coming down the path, and I'm really impressed that you've coalitioned all of these supporters to help build it. So congratulations on bringing it so far.
No problem there. I like doing these type of projects for the town. It's always nice. And I would like to see something like we did for the first playground. More of a community day, a lot of people there participating, bringing the food, setting things up, and it was just one of the best days that I can remember that we've had in this town. Mm. And there's still talks about that day and how there was a lot of people and a lot of fun. Oh. And I like to see that with this too.
It's very cool. Mm-hmm.
So are you all thinking about a concrete foundation?
Yes, it will be a concrete slab for sure.
So what do you think the next steps are? Develop out the plans?
The next step is really for you guys to say yes, to go ahead. And then we're going to try to, I'm going to be working with Mr. Harris. We're going to try to finite the figures, dollar figures for it, and then start doing an entire package. And then we can bring it back and present it to you with renderings of what it's going to look like.
I
think you'd be very impressed.
A clarifying question about the location. You mentioned an L area near the small playground. I know there's a very tiny playground that has a set of monkey bars that's near the Cal Ripken sheds, and then there's a small, like, preschool playground near in the back.
Annie, help me out on that.
Where exactly are we?
I think they're talking about
jump in, Joan. Jump
by
in.
By the first grade.
The location is between the south wing and the east wing.
Yeah.
So that's the
preschool playground.
Four, five, six, and the younger wing. There's kind of a grassy area there.
That's good size. I see. So on the grass, close to the building, not obstructing the driveway.
That's right.
Okay.
And right now, this is with donated funds. You're not asking us for any money.
No.
It's a beautiful thing.
If you want to give us some more, that's fine.
Well, it would be great if you would keep us up to date on budget, et cetera, and if anything changes, we would need a lot of advance notice of that.
The PTO has funds in our checking account that we've been sitting on for now 2 years.
Yep.
And people have been asking a lot of why are you holding all this money if we're still fundraising, and these have been earmarked for this project. Mm-hmm. And then also on February 8th, our next PTO meeting, we're gonna promote, Tim's gonna come join the meeting. If anyone in the community wants to come talk about it, it's gonna be an open forum.
I do think it's a great idea. So there's still one thought, I'm trying to think of locations. You know, putting it there, it'll get specific use during school. But I'm thinking, if you moved it out towards the fields a little bit more, could it get more multi-use, not only during school, but after school when other sports are? Because I know a lot of us that sit through baseball games and soccer games out there would also use it as well if it were closer to the fields. Mm-hmm. Putting it up there, it won't get weekend or evening use, I fear.
We looked at that area, but just based on there's like hills, yeah. And there was a driveway, mm-hmm. That was really seemed like the safest location.
Yeah. The only other spot that seems flat would be the, I guess that would be the north side, yes, on the grassy area by the basketball courts.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, but that does wind up being a parking lot a lot, yeah, of times.
Yeah.
And that's not where the kids play during recess, mm-hmm. So that's right. What we considered.
That makes sense. Yeah.
You know, if you guys want it someplace else, just tell us.
Yeah.
No, I think you make good points, Beth. I mean, yeah. I don't think there's an obvious other place to put it.
Right. We can buy you binoculars, Mr. Pfeiffer.
That's right.
You're going to need more than that soon.
You can sit in the shade.
Yeah, exactly. So, do we need a formal vote, or do we just need a yay, go forth?
Motion to express excitement.
Just say yay, go forth. I'll take a motion of expressed excitement.
I'll really second it.
Yay!
All in favor of expressed excitement?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, let me jump in here and say two things, because I'm reminded by talking about the elementary school. Number one, thank you, residents of Hadley, mm-hmm. for supporting the vote to add air conditioning to the elementary school. That is a much needed thing. So we appreciate the votes that the schools received, the support, and for the IT system, both much needed improvements to the Hadley Public Schools. And before we lose all of the parents in the audience, I don't know how long you're with us tonight, let me tell you that neither Roby Grant or I are planning on running again for the school committee. So there will be two open seats. Everyone in Hadley, there will be two open seats for the school committee. It's time to take out papers now. It really is a good and valuable and educational experience, and I believe you make a difference to the Hadley schools and to the people of Hadley. But for me, 12 years is enough, and it's time for a younger batch of parents to join, to serve. Welcome, take out papers. How is that? Do you think everyone's gonna run and take out papers now, Rosie?
I think the town clerk's gonna be mad.
I know, the town clerk's gonna be overwhelmed by.
Yeah. Can I just say that you guys have been such amazing leaders. And you're gonna be missed. Like, honestly, you've really been a guide.
Yet.
I know, but it's like imminent. And,
yes, it is.
And whomever thinks about pulling papers, we're a great team, I think. So you'd be in good company.
Yes.
It is a great team.
It is.
When does your terms expire?
April 7th.
As soon as there's an election.
We're done. Another couple of months.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And I don't know the deadlines for the papers. Do you, David?
This February.
It was in a weekly update I sent out to families, okay. And I'll send it out again.
It's not hard to get the signatures.
It's not. The timeline to pull it and get signatures, you just need to show up to one basketball game.
That's right.
You've got it.
One indoor soccer game, one basketball game.
That's it.
Done.
Right.
That's right. Yep. All right, we're on to parent petition.
That's correct. In your packet, you have a petition from our parents in Hadley, and certainly I would invite any parent who would like to speak to the petition. So this petition was submitted by parents of students at Hadley Elementary School, the current third grade. And requesting that the school committee give serious consideration, strongly encouraging the school committee to support having three fourth grade classrooms for this grade. And certainly, if any of the parents...
Three fourth grade classrooms for next year.
For next year.
Fall, yeah.
There are two this year?
I'm sorry?
There are two classrooms?
There are currently two.
Yeah.
And current enrollment right now is 47. This year, that grade has added students. It's been more of our, one of our more popular arrival points.
Do you guys want it?
What's the budget? What is budgeted now for next year for this grade?
So the budget that we'll be reviewing shows with the third grade, what happens with third grade, what happens if absolutely nothing changes, and what happens with the third grade added.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yep, so you'll have that information.
The third classroom.
The third classroom, excuse mm-hmm. me. A third classroom for fourth grade, mm-hmm. if I say that correctly.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think we'd be happy to say a little more, especially mm-hmm. if you have specific questions. But I know that this conversation among parents has been going on for several years, so it's not a new conversation. And I think that as the needs of the class as a whole emerged over time, it feels to us that to best support these students academically and as they make social emotional progress in school, that for all the reasons that children require support, this class in particular would do better with a third classroom and the support of that classroom being added.
And I can add to that, that this is a conversation, actually last year, and I don't expect you to have, yes, I remember that school committee meeting and that PowerPoint presentation you did, Annie, but we did go through positive behavioral intervention and support data. And this class is a class that has needed a lot of interventions in terms of helping them develop social and emotional skills and positive behaviors, and they've needed a lot of interventions academically. And we actually were able to arrange our educational support professional schedules, our classroom assistants, to try to have at least one dedicated to this grade this year. So we didn't immediately go for the most expensive option. We certainly attempted this year to put additional support in place, and while it's been helpful, I would agree that it is proven to be insufficient.
So Annie, based on the numbers you gave us, it looks like this class has 12, it's the highest, with the exception of grade 6, in the elementary school, it has the highest number of enrollment
mm-hmm.
With two classrooms.
Correct.
And it's 12 students higher than the next lowest class, which is grade 2.
Right, you're looking at your school choice slots.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Current grade 1, I'm sorry,
and
is
so
it 35?
This hasn't happened since I've been here, but it's my understanding that the practice has been when a grade hits about 50, that it's been split into mm-hmm. three. And as I said, this grade has grown this year, and I think one of the things that the parents have certainly brought up to me, and it's a very logical point, is if there's any chance or likelihood that we'll get close to that next year, wouldn't we want to start the year with children already with their assigned teacher rather than doing that some weeks into the start of the year.
Right.
The
and these haven't been choice slots that have increased this grade this year. This grade was not open to choice. These have been move-ins.
If we were to add a third teacher, would you add choice?
Yeah, I was going to ask that too.
So then that could change our choice numbers if you had a third classroom, certainly. Yep.
But isn't the number of two
teachers... Oh, I'm sorry. Or Joan, let me ask Joan that question.
Well, I would recommend that if you did split this class, that you would hold off at least a year before adding choice, because the whole reason we're trying to split it is to get a better teacher-student ratio and to give these kids more attention. And so to open it up right away to choice, you'll just balloon the class. We already know we have people who have been calling and inquiring about grade 3, and we say we have no mm-hmm. seats open. Mm-hmm. So we already know we have people waiting in the wings, but once again, if our goal is to try and get a better teacher-student mm-hmm. ratio and to really give a little bit of breathing room and address the needs in this class, I would really ask you to hold off at least for a year and see how it settles out with the three classes.
Mm-hmm. Can I push back on that a little bit, that we're about to review the budget, which I've had an advance review of the budget, and there, it would be easier to say yes to this if we could open it up to two seats or three seats to at least help offset the cost of the teacher, but professionally, for you, even two or three seats is too much?
Once again, you have to take all kids who apply to school mm-hmm. choice. And right now, we know what the needs of our current enrollment is, but we also know that some of the students or families who have been applying, their students have additional needs as well. So it would make it, we would be adding in a more than just an additional student kind of manner. So you are tapping into other resources in the school in terms of our special education staff and our school psychologists, et cetera. So I do hear the financial piece, believe me.
But there was a look of utter abject terror. No. If Joan had a white flag, she would have waved it. So
yes, I saw that. That's why I asked the question.
So can I ask, the current grade 6 mm-hmm. enrollment you said is 53?
No, that's next year.
Right. Yeah,
I'm looking at grade 7, though. The current grade 6 yep. enrollment is 53. So we're keeping those three classrooms there and just swapping in the upcoming current 5th grade going into 6th grade? Yes?
Mm-hmm. That's what I mean.
Yeah. Got it. So there's no other class that's going to potentially bounce up.
It does require adding a teacher.
Yes. Yes.
So it's another
yes.
FTE.
Yeah. Yes, it is.
The cost isn't estimated here.
It's in our draft budget.
It's about to come.
Yeah.
I see.
Yeah. So you could roughly estimate the cost at around $50,000.
But that benefits that one class for that 1 year, and that teacher obviously would progress with that class, or the next year it dramatically...
Then assuming that you didn't have changes... And no longer, and you could, because, so now you have a 6th grade with 3 classes next year, and assuming this is the case in a 4th grade, mm-hmm. your 6th graders move, and your census doesn't require you to have 2 grades with 3, then the reduction in force language of the contract kicks in. So it's not an automatic progression of a teacher. And when you open up a grade, you post it both internally and externally. So there could be a teacher currently in Hadley Elementary School who would say, I would really like to change grade assignments, or I'd like to be with that particular grade. So you would open it up, and if the census couldn't support it going forward, then it's just not an automatic assignment, and you stay with that assignment. Does that make sense?
Does it believe that if this class needs a third teacher for the 4th grade, would this class need a third teacher for the 5th grade?
Yeah, typically you maintain that. You yes. Right. You maintain the ratio.
Unless the numbers go down.
Unless the numbers go down, correct. And there's a parent in the audience.
Hi, my name is Marcy Gallo O'Connell. My daughter is a part of this group of students that we're talking about. I just wanted to offer a couple of concrete examples for you to chew on. So last year I was in contact frequently with Jeff Udall about this, advocating for this as well. I know it was put in at a low level at the budget. I don't know whether it even ended up coming to you all. So one of the things that happened last year and this year as well, there continue to be a lot of disruptions and that are taking away from class time. So as an example, last year, 3 times during the month of May, her class didn't have the art project that was scheduled, which, as you know, is not enough art. I wish we had art every single day. So it broke my heart to know that not once, not twice, but 3 times in 1 month's time. I'm involved, so I went and found out what was going on, and it had to do with being unable to get the children under control in order to give the lesson, which is simply not okay. And, you know, there were circumstances where maybe it was a few kids here, maybe a few more here, but whatever happened, 3 times within 1 month period, they missed art. And there were many kids who weren't involved in that paid the price for the kids that they couldn't get under control. There are instances as well where group punishment is having to happen more. For example, group missed time for recess because they're not able to control the line on the way to lunch or something of that matter, which I have to go on record as saying I'm never a fan of group punishment, and certainly I'm never a fan of missing recess. These children need that. I don't view that as a reward. I view that as a necessity. Speaking of the pavilion, you know, we know they need to get outside. So I just wanted to offer those couples. Certainly there are more, far too many more. And it is all children. All children are individuals, and they're all paying a price for this. And I do believe that I'm so grateful that we have the numbers that we have. Certainly I know people who are attending school districts where their children are the same age, and there are 29 and 30 and 31 children in their classroom. Mm-hmm. And while I get that you can still be taught, we have a higher standard here. And, you know, that's why my kids are here. And I want to be able to offer that both for my own daughter and for all of her peers without as many disruptions. And also to advocate for the teachers. My gosh, you know, this has been hard for them all, you know. And obviously they must speak up for themselves in whatever way they're able to. But this is for them too, and I've been a communicative parent to them, understanding that they do have these challenges, and I get it. And what can we do? And certainly, as you mentioned, there have been more pairs. We've been trying lots of different things this year and other years, and you know, they're just not enough. And hopefully, this will be so. Certainly, if you have any questions.
Annie, I do have a question. So the children stay the same. So what is it? What's the magic number? What is it about the lower numbers that will really address the kinds of things that she's saying?
So, and I also welcome Joan and Ms. Bell to chime in. But I would say that any time that we're able to provide that much more attention to a child, that is incredibly helpful. So if it allows a teacher to spend that much more time with a child or a couple of children, going over explicitly teaching social emotional expectations, going over academic work. And on the social emotional side, now I'm just speaking from personal experience, sometimes the ability to just pay a lot of attention to a youngster who needs it. They mature at different levels, they have different needs for adult attention. Doesn't make it wrong if a child needs more. And the ability to really establish a deeper bond with a child because you can spend more time, it helps children. It helps, for some children, it means everything in their ability to mature and to grow and to just to be in that, to have more adult attention. And it's certainly, in many cases, it's not only just helping the child who may be maturing at a slower rate or may just have a little more, just be a little more active, need a little more direction, but for the quiet child who quietly sees the majority, if not all, of the attention continually going to students who explicitly and overtly demand it with their behaviors, those little ones desperately need attention too, and they're not getting it, not because these other children are trying to be bad or trying to do anything. They're just more overt in their needs. So sometimes it isn't a magic number, and frankly, there's no research that supports a magic number. It's about looking at the children who are in front of you and saying, here's a group that together and individually seem to require a bit more adult attention. And even, I would say, even I suppose as a parent, you would think, well, what's the difference between a 3-kid sleepover and a 6-kid sleepover, right? Or what's 3 more kids? What's 3 more kids? Go have a sleepover. It's a lot. So, and I certainly would welcome any other feedback on that.
Well, if I may just offer, I have 3 kids who are all in the Hadley Public Schools. I'm on my 3rd child who happens to be in this grade, and I've never quite seen a grade like this. Mm-hmm. I remember when we had to agree upon not letting school choice into this grade, and I remember being really very relieved. I didn't know about this effort to get 47 signatures on a petition until just before last week, in part because I'm not that person who's going to go out and advocate for, like, the need of one child. And I'm I'm not close enough to what's going on in a specific grade to say, this is what this grade needs. Mm-hmm. But when I heard about the petition, I was thrilled. Mm-hmm. So you know where I stand.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask about, if mm-hmm. the current enrollment's 47 and we were to go down the path of approving this, I understand the argument about not adding school choice slots, but I also feel like we've been saying 50 has been the magic number. So part of me wonders why we wouldn't approve it, but say we'll open up three slots, and that would be potentially one school choice child per new classroom, knowing that if you limited it to three and you had more applicants than that, doesn't that then become the lottery system? Mm-hmm. I mean, and we've had that before with other grades. I think that would at least help offset the budget dilemma that we're going to have, while not massively changing the dynamics of the current school grade population that you've got.
You'd open up three slots in different grades?
No, I'd open up three in that grade to make it 50, the enrollment of 50, and add a third classroom.
Well, I guess the principal spoke to that, and I heard her.
Yeah.
Well, if you limit it to only, you know, one per class, it's probably doable, but I just wouldn't want to use your current benchmark for school choice seats, because then you're right back where you started. You're not having those small numbers. We already know this is a class that has needs in a variety mm-hmm. of different ways. And, you know, that's the purpose of one of the, you know, the major purpose for dividing the class. So
you would go from like a class size of 23, which sounds like you have currently,
that's our larger one,
to potentially 16 to 17 per class if you opened up three mm-hmm. slots and divided them up. Mm-hmm.
That's going to be a big experiential difference. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we can do that, right? We can put a cap on it, just mm-hmm. just
we
three.
We definitely can.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But
my question is, if I may, what about if we have further growth? The growth we've experienced in this grade is people moving to town and just happening to be have children in the third grade. And I guess I'm also concerned about some of the issues that Joan raised. If we open school choice and the applicants continue to have needs that are more significant in nature, or needs that are significant in nature, this is why we're here. We're talking about a cohort that has needs that are significant in nature. So I think we have to consider that carefully. It would be a shame if we sort of negated the work that we did here to try to best serve the children that are already here in terms of boosting them academically, meeting those social emotional needs and social emotional growth. So I think it's important that we consider the compromise, but also really think about all angles. If we have further growth of the cohort, and if we invite in more needs into this cohort that's already got a lot of them. Thank you for letting me pipe up.
When would we know about further growth of this cohort? Like, is that
all through the year?
No, up until just mid then.
Yeah. And when does that happen relative to locking down number of school choice seats?
Maybe I'm not understanding the question, but people move in at all times.
I think we're being asked to vote on school choice tonight, right?
Right. You're being asked to vote on school choice tonight, correct. And but in terms of knowing exactly who's moving in, maybe I'm misunderstanding the question, but historically, even this year, we had at least one. You could tell me how many move-ins. I know we had at least one in November, mm-hmm. October. At the end of October, early November, I can think of one.
We had one over the summer.
Yeah.
We just had one in third grade a couple weeks ago.
There's a whole bunch of new houses going in.
We generally are pretty careful and conservative with how many kids we allow mm-hmm. into each grade for choice for this very reason.
Yeah.
Is that we are conservative with our choice in numbers to make sure that even if unexpected children move to Hadley, we welcome them. And can do so with the classroom sizes that we've tried to establish.
Perhaps I'm misunderstanding. The school committee always has the option of expanding a choice slot or mm-hmm. revisiting it. You can't revoke choice from somebody that you've given mm-hmm. it to. Mm-hmm. And you can't do anything with choice that's based on knowledge of applicant, but you can expand choice out. You can say we want to add more seats at a later date, or you can.
So each choice seat brings in how much in revenue?
$5,000.
Right.
So we're saying potentially forego three seats at $5,000 for $15,000 for the opportunity to see what it feels like to have three classrooms and getting this grade under control.
Yep.
I would advocate for that because this class really is kind of slipping further behind. We just did our mid-year assessments, and they're making progress, but not nearly the kind of progress that we'd be really happy with. And when we looked at those results, it was really eye-opening in terms of these kids aren't getting what they need. There's just too many. You go into their classroom, and you can walk sideways between desks because there's so many desks in the classrooms. They really feel very overcrowded and congested.
So it's a little hard to say for certain because we haven't seen the budget yet. Right. Linda's the only one, and she's acting very conservative about this. But I support making this a priority in the budget, and with no added school choice slots, I don't think it's worth the risk for $15,000 in a $7 million budget.
We can always get that $15,000 in year two once we have solid ground.
Right.
We also had the CPAC families come and talk to us about increasing.
You have? Two? Right there.
Yeah. Right, so how do we balance out those needs? I mean, so, if that's also on the table.
Yeah, so Paul, I think that the needs of each, the needs are interwoven. I think that this would benefit all children. So I'm speaking as co-chair of the CPAC, but I also feel very strongly that the need of one child should not infringe upon the need of the other. If there's, you know, a need for a certain child to have sort of more of that adult interaction that Annie spoke to, that shouldn't take away from the child who, like she said, isn't, you know, as maybe demanding it in the same way. You know, I don't think this is about picking apart the grade and speaking to individual cases as much as the needs of this cohort are interwoven. Joan has spoken to their academics, we've talked about their social emotional growth. If this were one child from a special ed standpoint, maybe Pat could speak up for this, we would be talking about what we could do to better support this child who wasn't meeting academic standards or social emotional development. So now we're talking about a cohort where this is happening. I feel really strongly that this is the best move for this class as a whole. Every child will benefit from this.
Just to throw in a little bit, I love Annie's analogy of the party of three kids, but I would have gone a lot higher. We know what it looks like with 15 kids running in your house. And there is a certain calm and openness to learning when you can offer small group instruction. And these kids have not been able to get that, even when we add more adults to the classroom, because the environment changes so dramatically when you have crowded learning environments. And that's what we've tried everything else that we could to get to this point. And we haven't, you know, thought needlessly about, oh, well, we'll just split it up. And I think the, on the whole, the character of that year of students, and I do believe kids come in crops. You know, this year is a very challenging and large crop. So that for them to ever get firm ground under them as educated kids, we need to do something. And I'd say this is a good year to do it. They're not learning to read anymore. They're trying to read to learn. And we have to get those skills cemented. So I also support the idea. And the other thing about school choice, we have to be need blind. We don't know if we even had more children than seats that we decided to open. You don't know who those children are because we can't discriminate. Mm-hmm. So it's risky. You know, maybe it would be fabulous, but we also know that it's a risk that you take, and I hear that it's not one that would be a good gamble for these particular students right now.
So I'm hearing consensus that we will try to build this into the FY18 budget. Without opening school choice, preferably. Yes?
For this year.
Yes.
Yeah.
For 18.
Yep. Well, 17, 18, right?
Starting September. Oh, fiscal year 18. Yes, Mr. Pip?
Just a quick comment. I think something that should be borne in mind, with the mosque opening up in the near future, there'll be worship services there. They're planning the daycare. You may have an influx of families that want to live in Hadley because they want to be closer to where they worship. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how you figure that in.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You can't.
No.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, parents.
Thank you.
Run for school committee.
Take out papers.
Well, since we're on this, can we go to D, school choice, since we've all been looking at this table anyway?
Yes.
So this is the annual table administration has provided about what they consider are open slots K through 12.
Mm-hmm. Right.
With right now, the upcoming next year's fourth grade is at zero.
Right.
Any questions on this? And if not, I would take a motion to accept this 2017-18 school choice seats available.
Let me ask a question. Just we were starting to talk about how many grades have three classrooms, and right now it's grade six, right, in the elementary school. And that with the if we establish a third classroom for grade four, and these are our slots for this coming year, can we revisit in 18-19 the number of slots so that we aren't looking at letting go an educator but potentially trying to fill those seats?
We do it every year.
Every year. You at a minimally, you have to do it annually, set your slots, but there's nothing to prevent you from revisiting and opening it at expanding our slots throughout the year if you want to.
But you can't contract once you've had a vote, can
That's
you?
Right.
If the slots aren't...
If they're not
If they're
filled.
Not filled.
You
like
can,
we've
but
had
if
to move in some and we've automatically...
But if we've reduced. Committed, we
yes,
can't go back.
We can't say, you'll have to leave now.
Right.
We changed our mind. We can't do that.
Right. That's good.
Yes.
And are we getting many school choice folks or new people at the higher grades?
I feel, as a matter of fact, let me say we have in the past, and unfortunately that is creating some of what we'll see, this will be handed out in short order, around the budget. So our school choice revenues, we're anticipating a decrease in school choice revenues in this current fiscal year because we had 18 choice students graduate out of last year's class. And in June, another 12 will graduate. Mm-hmm. So certainly there are choice slots. Mr. Beck does a really fine job of encouraging people to choice in. Kids come in shadow. We don't advertise. Other districts do. Hatfield advertises. You may hear other ones on the radio. I know Hatfield does. But
Mohawk aggressively.
Still have plenty of Mohawk does.
Yep. Aggressively.
We have plenty of space at the upper grades.
These numbers do make it look like our enrollment, like everyone else's, is falling, is declining.
It's a population decline.
Those, mm-hmm. Yeah, those first four grades, they're
right.
Mm-hmm. Pretty small.
Yeah. Yeah, that is common. Well, as you know from the CES study, that's throughout Western Massachusetts.
That's why there's so much competition
in general.
We haven't had as bad of an experience as some other places, but it's everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Should we advertise?
Well, you mentioned requesting the census data, which I will do. Does that only tell us about planned enrollment for kindergarten, or can we get other numbers from that, too?
So we can get data from, I'm saying we, I can. I know that I'm pointing at Ruby because she's familiar with these data from CES. I can ask CES to provide us additional data. They've done some pretty good cohort analysis, and I can also get data from NESDEC that I can bring to our next school committee mm-hmm. meeting. The message is pretty clear across Western Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm.
We're up against declining population, mm-hmm. which we'll touch on another agenda item later with a neighboring district who's
yes,
up against
right.
the same
when
thing.
When we get to that item, I think we should be advertising to this neighboring district specifically. I have a mixed feeling about school choice. I think it's a cannibalistic endeavor in Western Massachusetts especially, and that you can be a school choice winner or a school choice loser, and if you're a winner, some other school district is a loser. Mm-hmm. And that it's hard for me to want to openly advertise knowing that it would hurt other districts around us. Mm-hmm. So, but I'm only chair for 2 more months.
It's hard, right? It does seem like a race to the bottom, but if others are doing it.
And one of the things that happens is when you become too school choice dependent, and there are districts around us that if school choice, if there was a policy reversal, if something happened, they literally would close their doors. Yeah.
And some are.
They can't live
without. So we can plan to be not dependent, but it helps.
No, you can't plan to be not dependent on school choice in this environment. We are dependent on school
choice.
We
are, yeah.
We fund a good chunk of our operating budget through school choice money.
Yep.
Then we should be aggressively advertising, I would say, because if we're 18, loss of 18 is going to hurt us that much because we're dependent, then we need to take care of ourselves.
Well, let's actually continue on. Everything is a flow.
Did you want to do a, I didn't let's get a motion.
Oh, sorry.
Vote for school choice.
I vote to accept the numbers as given for the 2017-2018 school choice slots.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you.
So let's talk about F and G.
Okay. Which?
No, E and F.
E and F.
Sorry.
So there are two things happening with Granby Public Schools. One is a letter that I wrote to the superintendent of Granby, Cheryl Stanton, that was in your packet. The town administrator of Granby is interested in pursuing a DLTA. No,
District Local Technical Assistance
Thank
Grant.
Thank you. I knew either you or David would tell me what that was. A District Local Technical Assistance Grant. So the letter in the packet is the Granby Town Administrator has evidence of our support to look at exploring sharing services for English language learners, special education services. Interestingly, we already do that with Granby. We have a shared board certified behavior analyst that we share with Granby. But we've identified some other areas that we would like to explore to see if we can achieve greater efficiency. In addition to that, Granby School Committee, I believe, is meeting tonight, either the school committee or the select board. But there has been some conversation about the possibility in Granby of tuitioning out their 7 through 12 students, and they're interested in seeking a partner. I wouldn't be asking the school committee to commit to being a partner, but before I even went down the path of starting to have conversations with them, I wanted to talk with the school committee about that. So in the face of declining enrollment for some school districts, that means they have no choice but to shut down their high schools and tuition out their children. That's what I present to you, and the regionalization efficiency grant is separate.
So does the state set the tuition? What do we charge them?
So I don't know the answer to that. I don't know the answer to that. I do know there, oh, Mark knows, thank goodness.
I mean, usually you work on an agreement. I mean, you do an assessment of the cost. What does it cost to educate the students? Put together that proposal, and then they'd have to be agreement on their side that was a fair cost for educating the students, and then you sign an agreement. So basically, agreement between the two school systems.
Oh, and I forgot we have experience here. Joan is the superintendent of a district that tuitioned kids, right? Yes. One of the districts in the supervisory union tuitioned kids out for high school.
And but in this era of school choice, I can't imagine that Grand Bay parents wouldn't want choices if they were going to tuition their kids out. So are you thinking that it would be one of the options? Or are
so
they talking
I
about
thought,
a specific?
I thought the agreement had to be locked in. But I learned from Linda and from Joan, because one of her districts had a choice of going to two different high schools. Although they had an agreement with one, the family still had a choice.
Okay.
So the town of Irving has a K through 6 school, and then 7 through 12, they tuition their kids to a high school.
Right.
And the last time, Joan and I have both knew about this, about half the kids went to half the kids go to Gilmontague, and half the kids go to Pioneer.
And they're going to Pioneer, though, as a choice student.
Yes.
So there's no agreement. It's just that's their option.
And I think Roe is the same, right?
Roe for a long time had tuitioned when Pat Bell and I were at Mohawk as administrators.
a tuition their students in two towns in Vermont. Halifax, right. Vermont also had the option where they had basically offered a $14,000 tuition and students could go to whichever secondary school they wanted to, and we managed to pick up two students from Halifax because they were close to the border, mm-hmm. and they could jump on the bus right over the border and get to Mohawk.
I guess I don't get it. Why would we do tuition over choice? Does it guarantee their students that they would have a spot?
Transportation is a big tipping point for those choices.
Okay.
Because you don't get transportation unless there's an agreement. And so if you wanted a choice away from the agreed upon tuition, you would be on your own for transporting your kid.
I see.
School choice would be if Roe had their own high school, right. Let's say. Then students would be choosing out of their high school. But with them not having a high school, the town committed a particular amount of money per student each year.
I see.
And either, in this particular case, they had an agreement with Mohawk. But students could also go to, I want to say it's North Adams,
mm-hmm.
Drury High School, or the other school that's up there that I can't think of, but Adams and North Adams.
Mm-hmm.
So just to be clear, what was in the packet was just about shared services but we've mm-hmm. expanded this conversation to something.
Right. So one is, what are we currently doing?
Okay.
One thing we're currently doing is the town administrator of Granby is seeking, and this is also important information. I think I'm grateful our town administrator is here. We expect the chairperson of the select board to be joining us. When we talk about the budget, this connects with the budget in terms of what are we doing? What are we actively doing to try to be more efficient, more effective, and share services? The district...
Local technical assistance.
Thank you. Is something that Granby is pursuing that we would benefit from if we could identify more places to share services. In addition to that, Hadley submitted a regionalization and efficiency implementation grant today for $200,000 for Granby, Hadley, and South Hadley to develop a special education program together, something that Ms. Bell has been in conversation with the special education director in South Hadley about. So we're working hard to try to work together, share services, increase efficiency. This other conversation, and it is far, far, far from being determined. I mean, I have no idea on the Granby side where this conversation actually is, right? Mm-hmm. They have a select board, they have a school committee, they have parents, I have no idea where it is. But I wanted you to know, this superintendent has said, this is certainly one of the options we're discussing. Would Hadley be willing to consider being a partner in this endeavor? Mm-hmm. To do the math, you're talking 360 students, roughly, right now at Granby, 7 through 12. If it were only school choice, which typically tuition agreements are more than the $5,000 for school choice, but just as school choice, it's $1.8 million, just at the school choice rate.
But in terms of numbers, that's a lot of students. Hopkins mm-hmm. can't absorb that many numbers.
In this physical plant right now, absolutely not.
Right.
Some of the things, again, going back to very initial, my goal was to determine, to be able to tell the superintendent, yes, we can continue a conversation, or no, the community, we don't have an appetite for this conversation. But today, he's gone. I even did talk to Tim Neihart.
Just walk through, Molly.
Said, please. I spoke with Tim Neihart and said, do you have ideas about physical building space in town? He had some ideas. He didn't think it was a completely impossible idea. Brian and I very quickly and Ms. Camuso just were throwing around ideas about could we even consider this as an opportunity to rethink what senior year might look like in terms of dual enrollment opportunities, internship opportunities, getting away from this traditional seat time of senior year mm-hmm. that could free up. So the first question is, we said today when Brian and April and I were talking, are we answering the question, can the physical plant absorb 360 children? Are we answering the question, are we willing to entertain whether or not we can provide an education? for a total of X many children. Nice. And I don't know that those are necessarily the same question if you redesign how you deliver instruction.
So one of the challenges that we've always faced is how do we provide the breadth of offerings for such a small school? And we look at regionalization and we think we can't, well, we wouldn't want to part with our own Hadley schools having a base. So what you're presenting is the opportunity to think about Hadley schools as a much bigger school serving one other district in particular. So, and if I gather correctly, you're saying like it could be 7,000 or 9,000 per head times 300 students, which is, if we chose that 7,000 rate, it's a little over 2 million
in
revenue a year.
Right.
So you could have a whole new building solving the Hopkins dilapidated building issue. I mean, what you're doing is you're opening the conversation
to look at possibilities. Because there are many, that's all I'm doing, because I want to say again, I don't want to speak for Granby here. All I have had is a couple of conversations with the superintendent of schools. And so I have no idea where the chair of their select board stands on this, where the chair of their school committee and their entire school committee, and where the community stands on this. But I didn't want to continue down this road of even just what do we have to take into consideration without
I personally don't see how we couldn't continue to pursue it. I think our future is fragile enough that we need to pursue this idea.
The chair of the Granby School Committee is also the CES rep, and he's a great guy. I would hope that maybe you could seek him out and have a conversation with Everett.
I will definitely do that.
Yeah,
I mean, it's when you imagine what could be possible, we could potentially have our cake and eat it too in terms of like breadth of services, larger school, better school, new building. I mean, definitely downsides, but it seems like something to further look at.
Yeah,
I agree. I mean, we just approved 50 slots of school choice positions here at Hopkins. I mean, part of this exploration, are they going to be looking at, you know, not necessarily going whole hog right away, but saying, hey, we could offer you 50 slots. I'd rather have 50 guaranteed kids coming in here paying tuition than rolling the dice hoping that we get people, you know, applying for school choice seats, which, again, if we're looking for ways to increase our revenue for our systems, that'd be one way to do it.
So tuition, if a child comes in with needing special education, does the town pay the extra, or is that?
There's often an increment that increases for the services that do have state rates attached to them.
Just like school choice. We always refer to school choice as $5,000, but anybody who looks at our school choice revenue, if they divided the school choice revenue by the number of students, you would clearly see it's not a flat $5,000. There's a special education increment that we get for school choice.
So the sending district is still responsible for sped costs.
Well, their
choice, but wouldn't necessarily refer tuition based. You'd have to work all that.
You'd have
out.
To make
you'd work
agreement.
It out in a tuition agreement.
You know, we couldn't have an agreement where we lost on the deal.
And also, the law is really clear. The town, I mean, we say the schools because I'm designated through the town administrator select board school committee to handle this piece, but the law is clear. The town of Hadley is responsible for the special education for all of the children living in this town. And so that obligation does not get absolved. And so certainly on the finance side of it, you work it out, but nothing, they come here, that doesn't mean now that the town is absolved of its obligation to those children.
Right.
So explore it.
Sure.
That's, consensus, explore it.
Yes, please.
Right.
Yep. You have all these handouts. I'll get handouts.
Thank you for... thanks for submitting that grant so quickly.
I'll bring that up in the budget too. Brian, do you mind terribly? There are, underneath the agenda, there are handouts, and we have color ones for you up here. They're actually Linda in their folder here.
That I'm handing out just to.
Yeah, you're handing them out to school committee, please.
Hopefully there's one there. All right, how many of these many things did we just do?
How many of what?
We got to G.
Oh.
We didn't get that far.
We didn't get that far, darn it.
We need to speed it up.
We're going to get there. Oh, goodness gracious.
Okay. Still on C.
Sorry, I haven't seen this.
Nope.
You guys haven't looked?
No. Can we just pass over page one and go to page two?
You can do whatever you want.
Yep.
I'll just go to short again.
Yep.
$191,000 unanticipated.
So this is a first blush at the budget. We can go back to page one. Let's go through the rest because this will provide you with an overview of it. So page two, the pie chart.
And the only thing I'll say about the bottom line with page one is that between when the school committee approved the budget in May, on May 23rd of 2016 for FY17, between that time and roughly November to December of this year, we've seen $191,000 of unanticipated costs. That's just in fiscal year 17.
Primarily of special ed.
And that's important to note because some of the things that one of the cost centers that increased the most is also driving up the bottom line in FY18. And so what we're looking at in the total budget, you have a graph that shows you where the greatest percentage of expenditures by cost center. So which cost centers consume or account for the largest percentage of the operating budget. 54% of that instructional leadership, teaching, and support are essentially all of your personnel who are providing direct services to students in the classroom. That includes classroom assistants. That piece also includes your building principals and your building secretaries. It does not include central office, and it does not include salaries that you would find in places like transportation, custodial, or health services.
Can I
yep.
just, this pie chart we're looking at is not FY17,
it's
but
FY18.
A preliminary look at FY18.
That's correct.
Thank you.
That's correct. And in addition to the pie chart, the actual amounts are in the next handout. So the actual dollar figures that correspond with those percentages, function expenditures as a percentage of total budget. This first amount, and you'll see on the final sheet, does not include that grade three teacher, but it is included for comparison purposes on the final handout. And I'll go through these and then you can go back and ask questions. The next handout has three boxes on it. Looks, so you see one that talks to you about expenses changing. These are double-sided. School choice revenue projections. So let me just walk you through this, what's happening here. This is to essentially demonstrate, and I think demonstrate clearly, it doesn't change the bottom line, but demonstrate that those expenditures that are within the school department's control are well under control. And so what you see in the upper left-hand corner is a box that says expense increases FY17 to FY18. That's designed to show to you where we anticipate some of the greatest in terms of percentage fluctuation from 17 to 18. So at this point, based on the number of students who have pulled applications and students currently enrolled in vocational and technical education, we anticipate an increase of roughly $119,000, or an increase of almost 25% on that line alone.
And that's assuming what level of increase for Smith Voc tuition?
We've had 11 additional students pull applications. We only have two graduating this year.
No, I mean, what is the cost in FY17 per student, and what have you assumed in 18?
I kept the cost exactly the same. Smith Voc technically should, I believe, be decreasing their tuition. Last year, they should have decreased their tuition. I believe last year, originally, they wanted it at 17.5. That it should have been, according to the formula, closer to 16.5. Someone from Smith is watching this, and I'm incorrect. Please call me tomorrow and correct me. And the superintendent and school committee, or the board of Smith, asked the commissioner of education to enact a certain provision. I think it's almost like a hold harmless provision. I don't know exactly what it's called. And the commissioner came down right in the middle. School districts said they should have to live with formulas just like we do. Smith said, we can't possibly live with that formula. The commissioner said, we'll call it 17K, kid, and call it even. And I believe that they're going to go for the same thing this year. So I assumed it at 17, and the calculation for Smith. That's not the total cost, that's the increase. So the total cost is about $595,000. It's on your, yeah, it's on the first page.
So it's a little bit of an unknown. We don't know.
We don't. We don't. And the other thing that we don't know is students with individual education plans are surcharged. So our surcharge for that this year is currently, I think, roughly about $13,000. Not per student, but our total surcharge right now for our students who are enrolled is roughly $13,000. I believe I assume the surcharge at 15, and I assume the enrollment based on the applications we had and assume that 17 would stay at 17. Several things could happen. The commissioner could not give them their wish again. That could go down to 16.5 or whatever the formula dictates it should be. Not all students could go just because they pulled applications. This is part of the difficulty. So I'll say I so appreciate David Nixon, our TAM administrator, being incredibly patient with me as he kindly and gently, starting back around Christmas time, could I please have your budget? Could I please have your budget? Perhaps today I could have your budget. That these parts are just moving. I mean, this is the best picture we have right now, but just that little bit of Smith-Volk tells you that a lot of things can change.
Annie, can I ask?
Yeah.
So the box, the page that has the four boxes, mm-hmm. or three big boxes, whatever, where it's showing, okay, total budget from FY17 to FY18 wound up being a 5% difference. However, if you factor out the vocational expense and transportation, that really our total budget difference would have been 3%.
Right. So those parentheses, essentially just like in accounting, take that out. So if you back out that expense and the corresponding transportation that goes with it, that's exactly right, Heather.
Okay.
If you did the same, and I'm in no way implying, these things aren't going away. These are legal and, more importantly, our moral obligations. So
we
I'm not arguing.
Them.
Exactly. Yeah. And as Linda said the other night at the big shindig, that was the name of the thing?
All boards.
The all boards meeting.
I think it was called the big shindig, wasn't it, Molly?
Next year, Molly.
That this is great for our local economy. This is not, we certainly don't want parents to, I don't want any parent to hear me criticizing these choices or calling them a problem. We don't set these tuitions. Mm-hmm. Same thing with out-of-district, special education out-of-district tuition. That's not special education costs. It's out-of-district tuitions that we do not set. If both of those costs were backed out of the budget, this is pretty powerful. Our entire operating budget, so steps, lanes, you name it, everything, with that fuel increase, $78,000.
Right.
1% increase on everything we control. So that message of what the school district can control, it's doing a pretty darn good job of controlling. But this is the reality. Now, with the special education, if you go to, so what do we do? Smith, we can talk about that a little bit. I do know that Pathfinder is interested and eager in presenting a proposal to Hadley Public Schools and perhaps to the school committee and the select board. So we can explore options in vocational education. I will be honest with you that the going rate, you can look on the Department of Elementary and Secondary's website for vocational tuitions. We don't set those. The state approves those once the vocational school sets those. And they're all pretty much in the same ballpark. The only difference when you're a member of a region is you get some transportation reimbursement, but you can see our transportation costs are not what the issue is. In terms of special education out of district, another place that I don't want folks to think we shrug our shoulders and say, well, it is what it is. I went through some of the cost saving activities that are already underway. So last year, in fiscal year 16, the school committee approved hiring a teacher so we could educate. I can tell you that there are three students that, had it not been for that, would currently be an out-of-district placement, so we wouldn't be adequately meeting their needs. And so that cost to district for that investment, that includes the personnel, it's not just a teacher, there are additional support personnel. That's a conservative out-of-district estimate. And so that's cost avoidance. That's not cash in pocket, but it's cost avoidance. So in FY18, that program will continue.
And you built the budget assuming this $133,000 is already not in the budget.
Yeah, this, that we're continuing. So in FY, that's cost avoidance, not anything I can back out. In FY18, we would continue with that program. Again, so we have cost avoidance. Why it looks like the cost avoidance went down is typically you can see increases between, what, Pat, 2 to 5% on out-of-district tuitions. I left the out-of-district tuition flat and did the real cost of the total employees associated with it. Mm-hmm. So service expansion enhancement at HES. So there is a place where we are potentially, we would like to hire a behavior analyst, what we would call a technician. It'd be a different position, a new position. We're currently paying a third-party contractor considerably more to offer services that we believe that if we had the position and hired in-house with the right training that we could provide. That would be that line that says service expansion enhancement in HES. So what you see when we go through the budget scenarios is that $72,000 is sitting in the budget you're looking at. So if we were to replace it, there's a potential for savings there. It's really important to know there's a lot of ifs that we could go at. We would start doing our work to get this accomplished, but we would need to post, we would need to hire. Those are the small pieces. We'd need to make sure that the team was in agreement, that this made sense. But also, it's not just a straight, oh, look, take 45 out of the budget, because it'll impact our circuit breaker revenue, right? So all of these things move at once. You can't just back that money out of the budget because it has an impact then on the circuit breaker revenues that we've applied in on the revenue side. The inter-district program, this is what we submitted today, the regionalization and efficiency grant with South Hadley and Granby. And so we anticipate if we were to get that grant, that with grant funds and shared costs, we could drastically drive down the cost in FY18. There'd be continued savings. The most drastic savings would be in FY18, but we'd continue to see savings because there'd be some grant monies that would benefit us in the first fiscal year. That also would be actual savings that if that came to pass, those expenses in the out-of-district part of the budget would be backed out, but we'd have to adjust our circuit breaker projections to apply to the revenue side. And then you had in that handout with the four boxes, that school choice revenue projections was on the upper right-hand corner. And school choice revenue projections, so the good news is we anticipate getting more circuit breaker next year. But of course, circuit breaker are monies that we receive when the cost of providing education for a student with special needs exceeds four times foundation. So when that cost gets over, let's say roughly $45,000, we then, for the amount above $45,000, get 70% of what's above $45,000. So this isn't like, yeehaw, we get a whole bunch of money back. We do get some back in circuit breaker, but it's not comparable to the expenditure, but we do get some. On the school choice side, so the only absolute number there is the top number, 713, 911, or 912 if you round. That was the figure, that was our 7116 balance from our town, from Justin, our town guy. I'm sorry, I don't know what his title is. Town accountant. I'm doing great with vocabulary tonight. From our town accountant.
Was Justin the town guy at the shindig?
Yes, he was. Our projected revenue, that $444,992, that's taken directly from the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. It's a true up of actual school choice in December. But it doesn't take into consideration special education increment. I've allowed for some special education increment. That's a difficult thing to absolutely project. It's something that's pretty involved that Pat does, and she'll be doing it with me so I can update this in the spring. And so then you see what right now it looks like based on our unanticipated expenses and other things, what we'll be applying to the FY17 budget. our balance that we would project on June 30. Our FY18 revenue based on FY17 numbers. I've already told you that those numbers are going to drop by 12, but I don't know who's going to come in, and I don't know what the special ed increment will be. And to get to what's applied in FY18 was simply to maintain a reserve for school committee of 500,000. All of that to say the only real number is the one at the top, and all the other ones will change. Not because I want to make them change, but they'll change. And so finally, we get to what does all this mean in terms of where we're at?
Now I wish I hadn't ripped everything apart.
Revenue needs, FY17, FY18 level, FY18 needs. So you see your revenues, what's happening with revenues. For the most part, we're assuming an increase in circuit breaker. Based on that circuit breaker numbers calculated in my budget workbook very specifically to by child, by placement, but if any of those placements change, circuit breaker is subject to change. Our nursing and our health grant, we're assuming will stay the same. We're assuming Title I and Title IIA will stay the same. Somewhat of a big if, although I believe that the census that drove the Title I FY17 was based on 2015 census data, and I believe that's the same data they'll use for FY18. So we kept that the same. Our 240 grant, we have a slight decrease projected there that's being conservative. The school choice numbers I went over with you, and amounts to be taken from pre-K revolving and our 391 grant. I want to really underscore that this is what we know now, our best estimates of revenue now. I've got to be crystal clear, and I know on the town side, I know you all understand this because you're in the exact same boat. You do the best you can with the information that you have, that these revenues are not, they're not concrete. I don't know who's coming to pre-K 100% at this moment in January. So I don't have a perfect picture of the revenue that will be captured in FY18 in our pre-K program. So I don't know who's coming. I don't know if they're full-time or part-time. And I don't know if they're in or out of district. All those things affect the rates. And I've walked you through some of the other things. So to the best of our knowledge, this is where we are at this moment, and these things could change. So that brings us to the total revenues that we need for FY17. If we did absolutely nothing except for kept everything the way it is in FY18, that FY18 needs, so if you look below that, right, these are, the school committee said, go out and ask people what they recommend. So the first thing on there, that ABA tech, again, that would be that we would have that position if we would trade out that position for services we're currently contracting out. But there was a reason that I didn't put that up there for all the reasons
the
I laid out to
45,000
you.
45,000-ish,
mm-hmm. Yeah,
depending on circuit breaker
this
change.
This 27 would, the goal is, would replace an out-of-district, well, I'm calling it out-of-district, a contracted services cost of roughly $72,000. The grade 3 classroom teacher you see there, the 35 would be increasing your part-time ed tech specialist to full-time, and that gives you a total of 112, which is the difference between FY18 level and FY18 needs. The FY18 level amount, roughly 8.2, ties directly back into your first sheet. You can see where that came from. It's the sum of all of your subtotals for your functions, and the 8.3 comes from that level plus 112.
Questions?
Small one. So the heating fuel oil is already, we already know it's going to go 46%.
We don't know. That's another thing that could change. That price was taken directly. We did call the Lower Pioneer Valley Educational Collaborative, I think, in December. And at that point, they told us to project a dollar per gallon increase. Mr. Schroeder suggested that. However, last week, I believe it was last week, that you saw something that was almost 40 cents per gallon less than that.
Right. He had suggested budgeting at 225. He said that was a figure he was using. However, we've now given them the gallons amount, and they're going out for bid. And the current rate on the NYMEX is $1.75. So fingers crossed, you know, if they end up coming up with a bid that's 50 cents lower than what we projected at, we can lower that number. But and right now, that was the best information we had from them.
And we also increased our transportation contract. I'll just leave it at we increased it somewhat conservatively. And so we don't know what that will be, right? We have to go out to bid on our transportation contract, that contract. So that's a sizable part of the budget.
So what percentage increase are we asking for local contribution?
The local contribution increase, do you mind pulling up? I'm sorry, I didn't bring my laptop.
It's about 6%,
5.7%.
Yeah. Thank you.
For a level?
The level. For the level, yeah. You also have it there too, right?
And thus the concern expressed earlier.
Mm-hmm.
I understand that now.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So one thing that Annie has talked to Hampshire County superintendents, and I have talked to Franklin County colleagues, and while this doesn't change the cost or obligation at all, many other school districts take out the vocational tuition and have it as a separate line item, not embedded within the school budget, just so that it is clear that that is a cost that we are legally obligated to pay and cannot control.
Mm-hmm.
So again, it doesn't do anything to the
right.
bottom line, but at least it would show that, you know, I agree with Annie, a pretty powerful number here, despite the bad news, is that a pretty powerful number is that those costs we can control, our budget is going up 1%.
Exactly.
That's
pretty remarkable.
Pretty good.
That's good. That's not right. That doesn't assume that we get the regionalization and efficiency grant.
No.
It doesn't assume the savings if we went with changing some special ed provision of services. So there is some good news in this budget.
Like, right, it's an accurate perception or accounting of our operating budget.
That said, our town is legally bound to provide the vocational and special ed needs of our children.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And I think it's worth saying that I know that our legislators are working really hard on this. I spoke with one today. There's been intense study of the formula for aid of the Chapter 70 formula, and now it's just insufficient. And so they have taken seriously the recommendations of the committee that looked at that, and I know that our legislators are looking to say what can we do, what is viable, and what action can we take that will not create problems that are perhaps even worse than the problems we currently face. But the current Chapter 70 formula assumes so that the money that the town gets, and the town gives us money well above Chapter 70, but the money that the town gets that is supposed to come to the schools, that formula assumes that a vocational student costs $13,382. And I've just shown you without transportation, on average, if you distribute transportation and special education surcharge, we're paying about $18,500 per student. It also caps. They only allow you to get credit for 4.75% of enrollment minus pre-K as your vocational enrollment. So your actual vocational enrollment does not drive that. It is 4.75 of the enrollment, not the actual vocational enrollment. Similarly, special education out of district, the formula assumes that it's approximately $37,000 in rounding to educate a student out of district. Actual, when you divide by all students in the cost, It's a little closer to 57,000 currently in FY17. And again, the formula says you only get to have 1% of your enrollment as counted towards special education out of district, five students. We have many more than five students. Mm-hmm. Special education in district, the formula says you can only count up to 3.75%. Doesn't matter how many people. So we're only allowed to get credit for 21 students. Pat, does that sound about right for how many students in district? 21?
That's about a quarter of them.
But that's what the formula allows. Again, this doesn't solve anything, but I think it's helpful for people to understand that the town, the schools, I mean, we're up against a formula that is inadequate. It's inadequate.
Questions?
What's the question in front of us on the budget? Just informational?
We just mm-hmm. wanted to have you guys have it presented to you.
Okay.
David, you have this now?
I have this, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And I think from here, tri-board will meet. Typically, we're conversing with FinCom. I'm assuming that this is the start of a conversation. This is, and as I've just indicated, it's also, there's a lot of things that are still at play. And as we get better information and more information, and as these things are adjusted, then we would give that information to the school committee and certainly give that information to the town to help them.
So what were the town budget instructions this year? Refresh my memory. What were the town budget instructions to departments?
The budget instructions were for level services for the departments, with any enhanced programs to be accounted for separately. Mm-hmm.
Good, I follow directions.
Yeah, so we met the assignment. Beautiful.
It's just, at least I followed the directions. It took me long enough to do it, but at least I followed the directions.
So at the next tri-board, will there be discussion? I mean, are we far enough along that we're going to be really getting into the weeds?
Well, I am supposed to present a balanced budget day after tomorrow, so thank you for the information.
You're such a good man, David. You really are.
It will be an interesting exercise.
Yeah.
I think the next tri-board meeting, we agreed that we would postpone it. It was supposed to be February 1st. Now it's scheduled for February 15th.
We wanted it closer to Valentine's Day.
Absolutely.
Because, you know,
absolutely.
We're a loving town that works well together.
I'm sure that when I present my information on Wednesday night, people will have a chance to digest it. On the 15th, we can have a productive conversation.
And if you haven't received this, I'm not endorsing a political position, but I strongly encourage Select Board and the School Committee to look up the Act for Modernizing the Foundation Budget for the 21st Century. It's SD 1905. It's sponsored by Senator Chang Diaz. So if I could just encourage you to educate yourselves on that, that would be really helpful. Speaking to the issue that I just brought up.
Questions?
For me? No. This is just the information we were looking for.
Good.
That is really kind of you to say that way, because I doubt it is exactly the information that the town was hoping for, but that was very magnanimous of you. Thank you.
I think the good thing about the efficiency and regionalization grant is that the word comes relatively quickly. Like we will know whether we have that grant before town meeting.
And tell me about the grant, because
right.
How much and for what?
Well, the District Local Technical Assistance Grants is the grant that goes to Pioneer Valley Planning Commission and can be used for traditional planning projects or regionalization projects, and mm-hmm. A requirement of the grant is that the regional planning agency must ask the towns what PVPC should do with the money. So that is why Granby is, and I assume, has Hadley already submitted its DLTA requests?
Yes, we've submitted it for stormwater management.
Do you think you could you guys talk about doing a support for the Granby project as well?
I misspoke. It was the regional efficiency grant that we got for the stormwater for DLTA.
Oh.
We looked at a shared financial director.
Oh, okay.
Feasibility study for such.
So if you could think about sending in a support letter to PVPC for the region, for the shared services project. The Efficiency and Regionalization Grant is a new grant program this year, funded with $2 million. This is the second round of spending. I believe in the first round, about $1.3 million of the $2 million was allocated.
Federal or state?
State, all state.
So how much could potentially come our way?
So $200,000 not coming directly to us to create a program. The savings we're projecting on that would be roughly $156,000 is what we'd see as the impact. So the money would be used to fund, to start a program that we're hoping would meet the needs of a couple of our students, allowing them to come to a less restrictive environment, a shared program. We would project savings of about $156,000. That'd be great. That'd be backed out of the expense side. It would affect the revenue side. It would affect Circuit Breaker. Because they would no longer, good news, the students, the cost would no longer meet the Circuit Breaker threshold. Remember I told you had to get over so much per pupil before you can even start to get back 70% of what you spent over that.
So it's a savings, but not not a direct
savings. No, it is a direct savings, but it will also affect the revenue side. Right. So the 156 is would be direct savings, roughly. I mean, these are estimates.
But our revenue goes down as well.
Yeah, totally.
We'll see. Competitive grant. This is the fourth application I know of. So, great. But the governor put $2 million in his budget for next year for this program as well. So if we don't get it this time, we can try again.
And Molly, I'm sure, I think when you were coming in, we just wrapped up a conversation about exploring the possibility. We'll see where Granby ends up with perhaps tuitioning in students from Granby. And certainly David was here for that, and he can bring the select board up to speed on that.
All right.
Whatever is next, can it be Mr. Beck so Josiah Beck can go home?
Yes. What is? What do we have to do? You just
Josiah
tell
Beck
us.
Is staring me down right now.
I bet he was.
Oh my gosh. You deserve an award, Josiah.
We all think it's really, really fascinating,
you know,
too.
All the way home about, you know, the foundation formula and things like that.
Yeah, I'm sure that was riveting. Sure, that's what he wants to know.
It's unjust. It's unfair. We can hear the conversation.
Yes. How about we start with I? You are, Mr. Beck, you are I, you are J, you are K. You're IJK.
Would you like to know what those things are, or do you have an agenda?
Or the middle one is I, is just a note with regard to the life skills training. Both of our health teachers in the 7th and 8th grade are going to go. It specifically provides life skill training for what is level one certification to incorporate curriculum around substance use and abuse. And so those two folks will come back and discuss where that might fit. Is it cognitively appropriate for these grade levels? Does it belong someplace else? Does it not belong in our curriculum? But it's great training because it's based on the results of this VIPI survey.
And I think being implemented in all of the Franklin County school districts with really, really impressive results.
That's good to know. There's extensive professional development that's been provided. So. The case of the social justice and equity workshop, we're fortunate to have Dan O'Donoghue, who has a friend, a colleague of his from School of Social Justice at the University of Massachusetts, who works as a collaborator for educational services, who has agreed to work with our faculty on a variety of topics around dealing with issues of equity. It can be really challenging for us as teachers to take on something that's outside of our field of expertise and try to facilitate a discussion about between students, a necessary discussion, necessary dialogue about very sensitive issues. And so Dan has been kind enough to work with his colleague to set up several sessions through our faculty meetings and then a continuation into April, and where we have the professional development day. And this will provide us the opportunity in between those sessions to begin implementing small advisory sessions where we can have discussions with students in small groups and you know, teach other students how to facilitate those conversations as well, so it's student-to-student dialogue about those issues.
Great. Sounds awesome.
Very cool.
Thank you.
And you're incomplete.
Yeah, and then the last one is just a vote to clarify language for the student handbook. I did include the track changes from the handbook.
They don't show up for me.
What was in the handbook prior with regard to incompletes? This is just a document that indicates the practice that we have had in place. So it clarifies for students and parents how to go through, how to engage in that process. Very often, or most often, incompletes are not requested by students or parents, but rather initiated by a teacher or a counselor or the nurse. It also cleans up old language which indicated, which we did not follow because it would have been inequitable or discriminatory, indicating that a student's grades would be changed at the next quarter, and that's not accurate or followable, if that's a word, because if a student, say, at the end of the quarter has a concussion, and they're an athlete, and so they're still able to participate, they don't wait until the third quarter to get their incomplete taken care of. When their incomplete is taken care of and the grades are verified as passing, they are then declared to be academically ineligible at that point in time, and that's consistent with MIA policy as well. So our prior expression of our policy was inconsistent with MIA practice, as well as our practice. And then the notes about behavioral standing, it's also just an addition of a definition to the student code of conduct. Our, like many other Massachusetts schools, we take a preliminary non-suspensive approach. And as we take a non-suspensive approach, there are occasionally students who do not serve their time, and we don't necessarily get the cooperation of their family. And what we do in those cases is we withhold privileges and participation in non-class events rather than suspending them from school to leverage them to take care of their obligations. While they're very few and far between, it's far more effective than going up the scale and jettisoning them from school and suspending them for a day. And will be far more effective in getting families positively involved to get them to adhere to their obligations. So again, something that is already a current practice, but we just wanted to add the definition to the code of conduct so that we can also put it on the forms that we have.
Mm-hmm. So that would require a motion of the right.
My scowl is this a motion? Because it's the handbook, can we just do it? Or do we have, because it's kind of a policy change, it's a first reading handbook, we can
it's
just do it, right?
Yeah. Anything in the handbook, I bring to school committee. Because
but we can just
we don't need
do
a
it
second.
Right now
we
without going through twice. First, second reading.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. You guys, want to make a motion to accept both changes?
Sure. Motion to accept the two changes, both changes to the incomplete policy and the behavioral standing to the, this is the Hopkins Academy handbook.
Mm-hmm. Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you all. Is that all you have for us?
Are you sure you want to stay, Josiah? Sure.
Yeah, anything?
Thank you.
Thank you. Where are we?
Policy exception. This was in your packet.
Yes.
Unit A contract.
This is the leave of absence.
Right.
Yeah.
So the person hasn't the individual hasn't met the leave of absence, the continuous employment requirement. Mm-hmm. They've been employed for 4 years, but they're willing to forego any compensation. Certainly, I believe that it'll be advantageous to us in terms of budget.
Yeah. So you support it?
Yeah.
Would we plan on backfilling that skill set anyway?
Are we going to rehire the position?
You have a long-term substitute for the year.
For the year.
And that's cost-effective?
Yeah.
I make a motion to support the proposed leave of absence.
I second the motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Good luck, Ms. Barton.
Can we go with it?
Yeah, really. Is there?
Did you just ask if you can coach us? I have what?
No. I want to go to
no, we ask
San
if
Diego,
we can go
UC
with
her. Santa Barbara.
Yeah.
Especially in the winter.
I answer.
Yeah.
Yes. All right. Superintendent goals.
We had the district goals, and there was a request of school committee members to make these personal, to make them superintendent goals, so that we can do a performance evaluation next year.
Mm-hmm. I asked Bill Deal from the collaborative. If you're the template, I took from Bill, my friend Bill.
And you're comfortable...
Probably looks familiar to some people at the table.
You're comfortable that these are all measurable. It seemed they were all measurable.
Yes, I don't have specific quantitative by this percentage for the reasons that we talked about last year at the evaluation.
Yep.
No, I think this is better than what was initially.
Yeah, sure. I will point out that under my student learning goal number 3, I do have a typo. So as Heather said, luckily I'm not being evaluated on my typing skills.
I'm or curious to see it, to find it now.
Object B instead of objective.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The one so place you want to mess up is your own goals. That's you know, mess it
if
up.
It were a fake word.
And I don't think we need a motion for that. We are just, we have consensus unless you'd like a motion. Okay.
Okay.
Oh my, look at us. Look at us flipping through the list down to L, principal search.
Yes. So I did survey our faculty at Hadley Elementary School, and the overwhelming majority would like us to seriously entertain and extend and to have Dr. Wickman remain as our interim for another year. There are many benefits to this. I mean, I'll just say we're not going to find Joan's skill set or experience at
ever.
We're in a good place right now. So this would be just, and what I provided for you in the packet was then the timeline. And I've spoken with Bill, oh goodness gracious, the other Bill, thank you, with Bill Erickson.
Mm-hmm.
So what the timeline would mean that is in March of this year that we would, with Bill Erickson, who assisted you with principal searches in the past, is a time to do this, and we wouldn't be charged for it in this fiscal year. So he will assist us with focus forums to speak with parents, with stakeholders, guardians, community members, school committee reps, staff and students. This is in order to put together the position description, the vacancy announcement, to get out there, this is what we're looking for, this is our community, this is the kind of person we'd like to apply, or somebody with these skill sets and these values. And that would be in spring of this year. In fall of next year, October and November, we identify representatives to serve on the screening committee. And I'm sorry, in spring of this year, we're not only having focus groups, but developing and administering online surveys to parents to help us build the position description, the announcement, and to help inform questions, interview questions and screening questions. And in the fall, we develop those interview questions and screening questions. We advertise the position December, and our interviews are in January. Our site visits are in January and January, February, and our final checking of references and offer is in February.
Does this get us kind of ahead of the pack?
It puts us squarely into search season. Yeah, okay. So right now anybody's inbox is inundated. No, this is search season right now. And so this is when administrators are getting inundated. So we want to certainly not be behind. And what I'd said to you last year is I felt like it was just too far behind.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
There's also a disadvantage to being too far out in front, because people everybody wait. Knows when search season is, so
right.
they are curious about what offers are going to come up.
Okay. Do we need a motion, or do we need to just say thank you?
Yeah, I think you can just say
thank you, Dr.
thank
Wickman.
Thank you. My pleasure.
We appreciate it.
The MOA, this will, I will have a request and approval on this. So the memorandum of understanding, we haven't currently had one between Hadley Public Schools and the Hadley Police Department. The reason I'm recommending this now is because Attorney Dupre recommended that we have one. And what a memorandum, and also I want to thank the Hadley Police Department, who they have in their budget designated their school liaison, essentially a school resource officer. The distinction is the officer isn't sitting here all the time. Typically, a school resource officer is sitting in the school department's budget in the schools. But they have identified somebody who has been trained, received the training for SRO, and has already been a great resource to the schools. Will be this week or next week. He's part of the PBIS rewards, right? Kids, yes. That might be a surprise reward, so maybe I should
Mom's award.
Well, we haven't announced it yet, but the kids knew about it. But yes, we haven't announced, we picked the winners this afternoon. We did the drawing, so we will be announcing that tomorrow. An email will be going out to all the families, telling them, you know, the rewards that were selected for January and who our winners were. And so, yes, announcement will be coming tomorrow.
Yes, very exciting. So they've been helpful. This helps. This lays out things that we take for granted, but it makes it clear so that school administration never acts as an agent of the police, what the rights of students are. And also, once the school committee approves it, then I would sign it, and we would also work with the DA's office. The DA's office signs it as well. They help us with professional development for our administrators, for the police department, and it just kind of lays out roles. So most districts have these things, just about every district that Fred represents, and so he was really clear that we should also have a memorandum. Yes, it is. Yes. Fred and Adam did this and sent it over.
Here's one typo.
That's
search
Fred's.
Search and seizure.
So thank you. Seven.
All searches conducted by the Hadley Police Department shall be comply with students' constitutional protected rights.
That doesn't make sense to you for some reason?
No. It's a small one.
We will fix it.
Okay. Any questions on this?
We need to make a motion.
Yes, we do.
Can I ask? Oh, I'm sorry. Sure. Did Mr. Beck review this as well?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. This will be helpful for him as well.
The principals are trained on this. Do teachers get trained on all of this legal stuff, or do they just refer?
Yes.
Over to
so it's even written on the part where the DA's kind of responsibility and how they work with us. Yes. So step one is schools committee says yes, we approve. I sign it. Then we get with DA, with the district attorney's office, Mr. Beck, Officer Romano, and say okay. Yeah.
Motion to enter into an agreement with the Hadley Police Department.
Who's signing this? Is this you or me?
Yes.
Okay.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you, everyone. And there is also the indirect cost assessment between the school department and town of Hadley.
That's all you, Mark.
What?
That's all you. Can it be?
It can be. Did David provide this?
He did, actually. So together, this was a conversation that this is not been codified anywhere. I think, I want to say the school committee members at some point as
Select
Board members.
Oh, I'm sorry, I jumped ahead.
That's
I
okay.
see now. I thought it was, sorry.
They've had a conversation in the past that we have been assessed indirect costs. We have been assessed costs. That's how they come to their net school spending. The costs are logical. You can see what's presented here. Yeah. This is based on an agreement and actually I think this one came from another town that TMS works in. So we started with a template. David took a look at it. I want to say the Select Board took a look at it, and then it would require our approval as well.
So this is no change in how the formula or assessment is done?
How they've been apportioning costs to
what
date.
What it's doing is kind of just making because one of the things that came up when we had the audit was there's no official agreement that anybody could put their hands on that said this is the way expenses are allocated. So this is basically just formalizing it so everybody knows what the rules are as to how the chargebacks would happen for the shared services.
Okay. And this would be a, this looks like, frankly, the signature lines. This is an entire each school committee signature. Mm-hmm. So I could take that. Because that's an agreement between the school committee and the Select Board. And I did forget there was an audit finding. That's the other reason we had to codify this.
Okay. Oh, so what are we doing?
We all sign it.
If you agree to it, if you make a motion to approve it, then you all sign it.
Do you have an original? Can we just use this one that's in front of me?
You can just use the one that's in front of me. That's okay.
Can I ask a question? On this agreement, 4A, the school grounds maintenance, is there any impact on the field's development activity to that relationship?
So it talks about maintenance.
Yeah.
They don't really do that. The school does most of the maintenance on the fields.
Yeah. No, there'd be nothing specific. So you're asking, would this change with the Fields Progress Project? Is that what you're asking me, Heather? Sorry.
Yeah, I'm just wondering if there needs to be any attention to that.
I wonder if that's considered sort of construction and building versus maintenance.
But you're saying if we increase the size, maybe the maintenance is higher, but Roby's saying we don't pay for DPW to...
But when we did this, when we do, if we ever do, then we would look at this.
Yeah.
I can only imagine that if something like there's, you know, there are pipes under our fields and stuff like the Hopkins Fields, there's a drainage ditch or something like that, they might get involved in that.
And really what this is...
they don't mow for us.
Yeah, this isn't...
Mark fields for us.
Yeah.
Some towns, the DPW does do the mowing, it takes care of all that kind of stuff.
And I think that what this is speaking to is it's not, if there's a perception that, okay, we're going to get a bill, they did this, they're going to give us a bill. This is just at the end of the year, when they do their end of year report, and the town reports that it's meeting net school spending, it exceeds net school spending. It's not just about the money that it gives us in terms of local contribution, it's also the support. So they apportion out costs. So it isn't, this doesn't become like, here's your bill, you came over and did this. It's how they'll apportion costs at the end of the year to demonstrate
the cutest
that they are, and they are well above to net school even without this.
It's cute. It's from California.
Okay.
So it would be what they actually did. If they came over and did something to us, they would apportion the costs accordingly.
Right. Do you want us to sign it now?
I already did. As a motion.
Did we have a motion?
No.
Motion to enter into an agreement with the select board about how we allocate indirect costs between the town and department.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Any questions on the personnel report?
No.
Look at, we've driven everyone out. Is there any other public comment?
We had other action items though.
Yes, we do. We have the business manager report, and we still need a field update. Woo!
We haven't turned page yet.
Okay. Ready for business manager report?
Yes, please.
All right. So I provided you with three documents. The first is the local school budget expenditure report and where that stands as of December 31st. And then also a report for grants and for the revolving accounts for that same information. So for the local budget, as you can see, through the course of December, we have 58.54% of the budget expended. As you can see, through most of the items, we're on track. We're about halfway through the year, and halfway through the expenditures, what's kind of driving up the overall budget is the fact that, as Superintendent McKenzie alluded to, we have some additional special education costs that have come in and will be impacting this budget. You know, as you mentioned, there's about 190,000 plus of services. And when we look at the budget and, you know, the cost savings that have happened through the course of the year, through hirings and things that we can look at, with those costs, we're still looking at a budget that would, if nothing else changed and we didn't look at monitoring our expenses, right now would be about $110,000 of the budget. So, you know, we'll be starting discussions about, you know, looking at expense freezes, because obviously the school department does have money overall in their budget, as you can see from the other accounts provided here, because we have under the grants, which are kind of separate from the budget and expended separately from the budget. Of the $500,000, we've expended about $170,000, and we have another $365,000 to expend, and they'll be fully expended. If you look at the circuit breaker and school choice, which you've got reports on already, you can see they have hefty balances, but obviously the goal is not to have to apply any of those out of any overage that happens in FY17. We'd rather manage it through the local budget expense watching. But then to just touch base on the revolving accounts, you can see athletics is at $6,700. I just want to bring your attention to school lunch. School lunch right now is in a deficit of $12,000. Last year, it ended the year in a deficit of $18,000, so that's something that the school has to consider covering. The current preschool balance is $85,000, and student activities has $77,000.
So the 12,000 lunch is the projection to go above 18,000 in deficit, or are we on track? Do you remember a month by month of last year?
I'll look back and see where we were at last year and see if we have a report for that. You know, at this point, it's conceivable because January will usually typically be a good month. The months that are going to hurt us are going to be February, because of vacations. Whenever you have a short week, those are the ones that tend to be more rare than negative. So,
February, April, and June when we lose our seniors.
Oh, right.
We can get these.
We could force the seniors to just come back for lunch every day.
We could do that.
Is anyone?
It seems like many of our utilities are overestimated.
Oh, I was going to bring that up too, yes. Because we have, those are encumbered based on the estimates that we did at the beginning of the year, so we'll go through those again and true them up. You'll also notice there's a maintenance line that's over, and that's because there's been a lot of maintenance items that have come up. The facilities director did a large open PO for $10,000. We haven't actually spent that, so that's putting that line over. That line most likely would go over as we continue through the course of the year, but right now it's over because there's money encumbered for anticipated expenses that we're going to have. So we'll take a look at those encumbrances and true them up this month. One of the things we've been working on was converting the software that we have, the accounting software that we've been using. The school is on version one of it, and the town is on version two, so they've been two totally separate systems. And this year, our goal was to get ourselves updated to version two for a couple reasons. Number one, it makes the transfer of data for the warrants easy, because rather than having to go over either via email or on a thumb drive, we can now hit a button and then they'll transfer through the system. The other thing it does is give us cloud-based view, so you don't necessarily have to be sitting in a particular machine to access the reports. So we just kind of completed that process. As of today, we had Vadar in and doing some training. So, we kind of held off on doing some other stuff with the budget because we wanted to get this in and done and successful. So we'll now take a look at those other items.
And the IT upgrade and the air conditioners, what's the timing for that? I assume we're going to hopefully put the air conditionings in over the summer. So in the beginning of 18?
So I did tell the town asked, because it would be helpful to the town if we could wait until next fiscal year, which July and August. We'll coordinate that with the town administrator. I went in ahead and said if it is helpful to the town, which they were clear that it was, that we would wait until next fiscal year. I'll bring an update as to when they're thinking about coordinating those projects.
So does that mean we need to start getting bids before then so they can...
Although I believe that there are two HVAC projects, if I'm not mistaken, I believe there's one also in public safety.
The police station, yeah.
And so my hope would be that the town would handle the bid, and I'm pretty sure that David intends on handling the bid, okay. Which would be helpful, that they'd coordinate those projects. And
okay, they do the school when they do the other.
Yeah.
Okay, nice.
And go out and do one.
So there really is not much of a role for the school committee there in that, is there?
No, you did the legwork already. We have it, it's passed, and now I'm grateful that that the town is willing, most likely, to handle the bid, if that makes sense. That would be really helpful.
And I know you're not the technical expert, but it's going to be the mini splits, things
yes.
like this. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Are you going to personally install them?
I'm thinking no. about it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll save us some money. Okay.
And the tech, there's no timeline on tech. So we have the list. You guys saw the last list that went there, and we can begin purchasing. That's ready to go.
Great.
Can you remind me, did we increase our legal fees?
Yes.
I saw that.
Mm-hmm.
You did.
Yeah, we did that.
We did, but please know in FY18 that we moved Dupre Law Firm to take over special education, which means we're not paying the collaborative retainer. The collaborative retainer was $3,500. The increase at Dupre was $3,600.
Right.
So it's almost, it's $100 more.
Okay.
Fred's a bargain also.
Right.
His rates are
right.
very reasonable.
And we have more access.
Right.
The collaborative retainer was great, but we're getting more access, and it was almost a net impact of zero.
Are you good? You done?
Yeah, I just looked last year at this time. Food service was $9,000 in the hole, so it's a little $3,000 more than last year.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's not good.
No, that's not great. Okay. Hello, Policy Committee. Anything?
Got nothing this week.
No,
we're meeting this week.
March
2nd.
Oh,
I don't think so.
March 2nd.
You just throw me out.
I thought it was February 2nd.
Robbie's like, wait a minute. We're meeting on April 8th.
March is fine.
March 2nd. I can't let you leave without a policy meeting, Robbie.
Yes.
Come on now.
Tri Board meets on February 17th. 15th, sorry.
Next week.
I'll be the gatekeeper tonight.
Yeah. And it was good to have two members of the select board and the town administrator here for our first mm-hmm. discussion. All boards meeting. Was it only you and I that went?
It was.
It was fine.
Mm-hmm. It was good.
It was a shindig.
What? It was a shindig, yeah.
It was a shindig.
Paul, how are we doing?
On the fields?
Yes.
I want to make sure I get the date right. I know Ruby's listening.
I can help you with that. Right?
So we should announce that on February 8th at 6:30 here at Hopkins, potentially in the gym.
In the gym, because we want to strongly encourage people to first stop by the spaghetti supper at 5:30
okay.
Support our kids going to Nicaragua. And then...
Excellent. So we're going to have an open house. Thank you to the CPA for providing us $15,000 in funds to hire a designer. We've hired Berkshire Design Group, who have already, in the past, had done an excellent design for revising the Hopkins athletic fields. We are going to take a look at those. We're not starting from scratch. We've got a great design already in pocket. But what we're doing is inviting the public to come take a look at those fields, that design. See how it is. You know, it's been a while since folks have looked at it. Let's refresh it, take a look, and talk about what how it looks going forward. And are there things we want to add, things we want to change, within reason, of course. Dollars, of course, are going to be the parameters about what's possible. We want to get public input, public ideas. We want to break up what we have now as a design into multiple phases, two, maybe three phases, so that they're more manageable, that they're affordable, little chunks. We want to talk about, you know, getting back to what Tim and Beth mentioned, where volunteers can assist in revising the fields. So that'll be the discussion. We'll have Peter Wells from the Berkshire Design Group giving us a presentation on what's already been done, and we can go over that and then talk about revisions to that ideas. If need be, we'll also be looking for volunteers after that to form a little committee to work on helping to implement that. Fundraising, I think, but if we do get some ideas from that, Peter will take it back, make some revisions, and if we have a small core group, we can keep bouncing some ideas off of them. So everybody's welcome. Again, it's February 8th. I think it's a Wednesday at 6:30.
Okay. In the gym, did you say?
In the
Not
gym.
The cafeteria?
And so basically, I have
because
neighbors.
Oh, because the cafeteria
butters.
Okay.
So basically, the format is going to be a presentation of the design and then talk about maybe the timeline for the redevelopment, that kind of thing?
Yeah, talk about so how you would break it up into phases, right? Because I think there is some staging because you always want to have some fields accessible. And Peter was mentioning, you know, you want a good 9 to 18 months where you're staying off some of this field. So we're going to be constrained, I think, since it's such high-use areas. I think as you all did with your original design, you want to maximize the field, the parts of the field that are currently in agricultural production. You put those into sports fields. So that's the kind of thing in phasing that we've, and the current design, there's also a public path around there. So there'll be public access. So there'll be probably some questions about public access. But you know, that when I talk to parents now that have kids that are just getting into Hopkins that weren't part of the original design process in the past, they ask things like, well, what about putting up lights? What about doing all this? So those ideas, I think, will come up, and we'll have to talk about those. Things like that obviously cost money and change the design quite a bit.
Okay. I will let neighbors know
that
are there, because it's hard to get information.
I was going to send out, after tonight, I was going to send out a notice on the Facebook page, and Annie's going to put it in her...
I will, and what I need to remember on that weekly email is I have to consistently remember to send it separately to school committee. Because it goes to parents, that's why I forget. Yeah. And that way, there'll be information there that you could also pass on if you wanted to.
So if there are other ways to advertise it, I'd love as many people as want to come.
Well, one thing to consider is, like, we have great access to the TV5 advertisements that go up.
Media now is what it's
Hadley
called.
Hadley Media. I think it would be great to just come up with one or two PowerPoint messages if you wanted to, like maybe even show in sequence and just get the word out to a broader audience who may not have kids in the school but may own timber production places and quarries and other things like that. I imagine that you could potentially get a cast a wider net if you were to
do that. So to place advertisements on Hadley Media now?
Yes.
Okay.
I do have warrant articles next to this. Is it safe to assume, given the generosity of the town, that we're not looking to place anything on a warrant article in this current warrant? Is that
Just the budget.
Just the, that's, yeah, so I figured that was.
That's the request.
Yeah.
From the schools.
Well, you mean about the fields?
No, I mean about capital plan in general, because they had given us the entire tech that was spread over a 3-year period. We received the entire tech, received the air conditioning, and so warrant articles are due. I made an assumption that I want to check out, that given the increases we're anticipating in FY18 and the fact that the entire tech article was funded, that we wouldn't be looking to put something on for the spring warrant.
So I don't have it in front of me, you know, the girls' locker room here.
Yeah, I can't remember what the capital plan was.
The girls' locker room was, I think, in FY18, $400,000, but that was bid it out a long time ago.
We're in no position to put that on a warrant because we have no idea of the cost.
Yeah, so I agree with that. I think we should begin to get updated estimates, but I feel like there was something, not the grease traps, but something else, smaller dollar amount.
Parking grease traps were down there, parking lot down there, they were further down on the list.
What, the grease traps? No, I think we put them out.
Did we put them out that far?
Didn't we already take care of that?
Yeah, anyway, we should just check to make sure. I feel like there was one, like, under $100,000 that was on there, because I was just looking at it.
Okay.
I have also, about the fields, I know a year or so ago, I think I brought information and maybe didn't get to the right people, that one of the abutters to the girls' softball field is having an issue with foul balls coming into her yard to the extent that she's afraid to use her yard. She asked that we look into extending the backboard because changes in the technology of the game have made those balls go farther.
We did do some corrections. I can't remember exactly what we did. But I'll make sure that you have that information, because what it could be is that I'll give you the information about the adjustments that we made. I know that Mr. Mish did take some action, and so did Mr. Sudnick. I mean, they coordinated something, but it could be that it was insufficient. Okay. So I'll get you what it was, and if a problem is continuing at the same rate, then clearly we need to look again.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Amira. Collaborative.
Yes. So, when I joined the collaborative, I knew that I would not be able to make the January meeting because I delivered the keynote address to 1,000 people in California for the Association of American Colleges and Universities.
Nice.
I know. It was pretty amazing. So instead, I'll be going to the meeting in March.
Okay.
And I will share information from minutes that I received from them to all of you.
All right, so then I have...
Can I add something?
Oh, yes?
Sorry, a report on negotiations, school bus.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay. We're actively working on that. We're actually meeting with them this week on Friday morning, and we, I believe, expect to receive their kind of first financial proposal to us this Friday, because we've been working on just laying the groundwork and the baseline. Annie, is that...
That is correct. I just realized that I am going to be there on Friday morning. I didn't have it in my calendar. That was that look on my face. That's not my calendar. Thank you for saying that.
Good.
Thank you for doing that.
It's moving.
Excellent.
Boy, I'm glad you brought that.
I have that the only final three things we need to do are we need two more motions, actions about the head cook position and the food services director, and then we need to make sure we're good on our next meeting date.
Mm-hmm.
So, I would take a motion to create a head cook position.
Motion to create a head cook position for each building with the job description that we had outlined.
Mm-hmm. Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And then we talked about increasing the food services director's contract from 190 days to 198 days to match what she has been providing to us for years.
Hmm. Motion to increase the food service director's contract to 198 days to reflect the hard work she is putting in every year, the
Thank you. Eight extra days.
Second.
All right, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Wow, people.
Wow.
Okay. When is our next meeting date, and is everyone in town?
27th?
Did you say the 22nd? 27th sounds good. Yeah, okay.
27th? I'm in town.
I'm
just looking. I'm planning on coming.
Yeah, I don't travel.
Ami?
Hey.
We got a quorum.
We have a quorum, February 27th. Would anyone like to do a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Thank you so much. Second, all in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for holding out, everyone.
Thank you.
That was a long one.